love this atmosphere. Go ahead and have a seat. Get your Bibles out. A couple of weeks ago, Pastor Deborah ministered on a Sunday night, and she talked about the subject of prayer. And I felt strongly in my heart that we needed to launch into some prayer as a church. I don't know how long we're going to go, but I've got mapped out at the very least the next 4 weeks up until Easter. We're going to have the rockin' Easter family night where the different departments come together, and we have the kids and the youth, young adults, different ministries that do some things. And so at the very least for the next 4 weeks, I want to take some time out and just pray. And, you know, it's neat because there are churches that are all over the place that are doing the same thing. Our friends at Abundant Living, every Friday night, they're having a prayer service. Lou Engle from The Call is calling people to pray and to ask God for revival in America, about a 110-year anniversary of the Azusa Street revivals. And churches are just kind of being led back into prayer. And I believe that, you know, in 2016, it's going to be the best year of our lives. God has some great, mighty, wonderful things in store for us. But that doesn't just happen because God is good. Do you know that? See, sometimes we think that, you know, things are going to happen just because God's good. But yet God left His Spirit and left the church on the earth and wants us to do something. God wants us to use our authority that He's left us. God wants us to preach the gospel. God wants us to go out and do good works. God wants us to pray and ask God and allow God to move on the earth. And it's a neat thing when we can connect with God in prayer. Tonight, the message title is, if you want to take some notes down, is Prayer Is. And I don't know if the other guys that'll do Sunday nights that come, we'd kind of do a rotating thing with the teaching team. I don't know if they're going to continue this or not, but if I'm in the pulpit, I'll continue this, what prayer is. You could fill in that blank with a lot of stuff. Prayer is powerful. Prayer is awesome. Prayer is, striking the winning blow, and obedience is gathering the results. Great quote, right? Lots of things that you could say about prayer, but tonight I want to focus, like I mentioned before, that prayer is a God connection. Prayer is a God connection. See, that seems like it would go without saying. You know, we would probably think like, oh man, you know, don't you have to connect with God in prayer? And yet Jesus had to rebuke people about that, right? Because if it's just empty, meaningless words, is it really prayer? See, Jesus said, with vain repetitions and idle babblings, the Pharisees come and they lift up their prayers. And He said, these people draw near to Me with their lips, but their hearts are far from Me. Remember the first two words that Jesus taught in the model prayer? What were those first two words? Our Father, right? See, our very first approach to prayer should not be an approach to our problem, should not be an approach to our situation, should not be an approach to our need, but rather it should be a connection with God, that when we come to God, we connect with Him. You know, there's times where my kids will run in the door and the first thing out of their mouth is, I'm hungry. I want dinner. Can we go to the store and get this toy that I've been saving up my money for? And I always do the same thing. My wife does it pretty good too. She's always like this, hi, you know, like, hello, it's me here. How about a connection with me first and then we'll talk about dinner or whatever your need is. And I believe God as Father is the same way. You know, there's times where we come into the presence of God and we spit out every need, every problem, every trial, every frustration, every part of our day. And God's standing there going, hi. He knows your needs. He knows them before they ever leave your lips. And yet, He wants us to approach. Great section of scripture in John chapter 16, verse number 23 through verse number 27. Jesus is teaching His disciples. He's been giving them a lot of lessons, and they've been hearing Him talk in figurative sense about vines and branches and different things that are taking place, the vine dresser. And, you know, the disciples oftentimes when Jesus used parables, they were scratching their heads going, what are you talking about? Can you just tell us, you know? And here Jesus starts to speak openly to them, starts to speak in plain terms. And Jesus is talking about how He is going to be crucified, that He's going to raise again on the third day, and then He's going to go to the Father, and He says He's going to send the Holy Spirit. And take a look at what He talks to them about prayer. Look at what He says in John chapter 16, starting verse number 23. We're going to read through verse number 27. Jesus says, and in that day, in other words, in the day when I go to the Father and I send the Spirit to you, you know, that's the day we're living in now. In that day, you will ask me nothing. Doesn't that seem weird? We're not going to ask Jesus for anything. You know, oftentimes we think of prayer as, you know, Jesus, do this, Jesus, do that. And yet Jesus says, you will ask me nothing. Not going to come to me. Look at what he says. He says, most assuredly, I say to you, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you. In other words, Jesus gave us a tool in prayer. He gave us his very name, his authority. We have permission to enter into the throne room of heaven and approach the King of glory. We can come to the Father's throne, and we can now connect with God in the name of Jesus. Jesus says, you don't have to ask me anything. You can go to the Father. In fact, that was Jesus' purpose, was to reveal the Father and to open the way to the Father. And so now we as a church can approach Father God in the name of Jesus with our prayers. Look at what he says in verse number 24. Until now you've asked nothing in my name. See, they weren't praying to the Father in Jesus' name yet. Jesus was giving them this tool. And now as a church, we pray, and it's almost as if we think in Jesus' name is just the closer to our prayer before we say amen. And yet God is saying, no, this is the key to your prayers. This is the connection point to your prayers. Jesus is the door. Jesus is the way. Jesus is the ladder. Jesus is the one that connects us to the Father. And so he says, up until now, you haven't had that connection, but now you do. Look at what he says. Ask, and you will receive. Don't feel bad about asking. He's giving you permission. And he says that your joy may be full. I don't know if you've ever experienced this, but there's been times where I have been in a slump. I have just been down, discouraged, depressed. Sometimes I don't even know why. Been tired, didn't feel like I could make it, felt beat up by the world or by sin or by the devil or whatever it was. And when I connected with God and I went to God and I had that God connection in the name of Jesus, I came out of that time of prayer feeling invigorated, feeling clean, feeling good, feeling strong, feeling like I could face the day or like I could take on the world. See, he says that your joy may be full. Verse 25, these things I have spoken to you in figurative language, but the time is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figurative language, but I will tell you plainly about who? The Father. See, Jesus was always revealing the Father. Verse 26, in that day you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I shall pray the Father for you. Jesus isn't going to do the work of prayer for you. He will intercede on your behalf, but he wants you to have a real, relevant God connection each and every day of your life. He wants you to go into the very presence of the Father. And then he goes on and he says, verse 27, for the Father himself loves you. Isn't that amazing? This is the God of the Old Testament and the God of the New Testament. This is the eternal Father. Sometimes we think of him and we think of him in terms of he's angry, he's ready to smite people, he wiped out people, he wiped out nations. He was an angry God in the Old Testament. Then Jesus comes along and he's love and he shows us the loving side of God. No, God has always been loving. In fact, if you read in the Old Testament, you'll find as many verses about the love of God, the long-suffering of God, the kindness of God, the gentleness of God, the compassionate God, full of mercy and loving kindness, that his love endures forever. That's the God of the Old Testament, and that's the God of the New Testament that we serve today. Jesus has opened the way because God is holy and just. We didn't have permission before to approach at any time that we wanted to or in any place that we wanted to. But now Jesus says, I've given you the keys to open the door to get into the very presence of God because the Father loves you. See, that's what God wanted. That was God's plan from eternity past. That's why Jesus Christ was the Lamb slain before the foundation of the world, because God loves you so much that he wanted to connect with you every day and for eternity. And so he says, for the Father himself loves you because you have loved me and have believed that I came forth from God. In other words, when you set your heart and your life on Jesus, now the way is open for you to connect with the Father. A couple of good quotes. Richard Foster said, real prayer comes not from gritting our teeth, but from falling in love. See, when you fall in love with God and your heart just rejoices, you know, on Sunday mornings, we were in the marriage series and we were reading through the Song of Solomon, and the beloved was the picture of God, and the Shulamite was the wife. And she was saying, I'm lovesick. When can I be with him? See, when you fall in love with God and you say, I'm lovesick, when can I be with God again? See, you guys are here on a Sunday night. You guys are pressing into the presence of God. And I know that's your heart. And prayer doesn't come just because you grit your teeth or you sweat or you have the right sounding words. And we're going to pray tonight. And you're going to hear some people pray. I don't want you to feel like, man, I could never do that. No, you can do more than that. You can connect with the Father. Anyone can spit. Anyone can shout. Anyone can have veins popping out of their neck. Anybody can cheer or scream or speak eloquently and use $20 words out of the dictionary. Anybody can do that. But not everyone can connect with God. Only those who have believed in Jesus' name and love him now can connect with the Father. Another great quote from D.L. Moody, we ought to see the face of God every morning before we see the face of man. Isn't that awesome? See, we need to connect with God. And out of that connection with God will come everything else in life. Sometimes people say, well, I'm just too busy to pray. No, you're not. Your priorities are messed up. See, and when you prioritize God, all the rest of your life will come in order, because the Father will now be organizing your day. The Father will now be ordering things. The Father will be arranging your life because he's priority number one. It's just like tithing, right? Finances don't work until you give God the first part. And when you give God your heart, and when you give God your life, and when you give God the priority, the first part, and you say, God, you're number one, and you connect with God, you may not have a lot of time in the morning, but if you can have a God connection in the morning, it will make all the difference. Maybe you have a lot of time at night or in the afternoon or something like that where you can press in more and where you can pray more or where you can connect with the Father. Whatever it is, make sure that he's the priority and that he has first place. See, answers to prayers come from God. They don't come from angels or from the stock market or from the economy or from the government. They don't come from Pastor Dan or the Rock Church or any of our leaders. They don't come from your relatives or your family members. You're not going to find them in the mailbox, even though God might use some of those things to deliver them to you. Answers from prayers come from God. Matthew chapter 6, verse 6, but when you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut your door, pray to your Father who is in the secret place. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. See, it's when you connect with the Father that now you can get answers to prayers. You ever prayed and wondered, God, why are my prayers not getting answered? Maybe it's because you haven't really been praying. Maybe it's because you haven't been connecting with God. You've been putting a coin in a machine and pulling a lever and wondering, why isn't anything coming out? God is not a coin machine. God's not a gumball machine. He's not a slot machine. He's God. Connect with him. And when you connect with him, he'll now say, hey, I got this covered. He'll reward you openly. Another great verse in 1 John 5, 14 and 15. Now this is the confidence that we have where? In him. That if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, look at this, whatever we ask, don't you know we could ask, right? I mean, come on, we live in a day and age where we could ask big. I can dream big, God. Are you sure? Are you sure, Lord, that you want to answer my prayers, God? Because, God, you give me an inch, I'll take a mile. I'm a greedy little preacher, right? And yet he says, if we know that he hears us because we've asked according to his will, then whatever we ask, that means that what we've asked is according to his will. We know that we have the petitions that we've asked of him. You can be assured that when you pray the will of the Father, that you've got it. You can just kind of dust your hands off and say, good, I'm just waiting to see how God's going to bring it about. And Lord, if you need me to do anything to help in this process, God, here I am, I'm available. Lord, I'm going to do my part, and God, I know you'll do your part because I've asked according to your will. See, sometimes people say, well, I don't know what the will of God is. I don't know where God wants me to go to school or who he wants me to marry or any of that kind of stuff. See, if you can find it in the Bible, then you can ask for it. And so you may not know who, but you might know what. I don't know who to marry, but I know what God wants me to marry somebody godly. God wants me to marry somebody who's spiritually mature and growing in their walk with the Lord. And God wants me to, see, you may not know who, but you know what? Start praying for what you know is the will of God. God, please bring me in the right time, in the right way, the right person, God, somebody who's godly and growing in their relationship with you, Lord, that will encourage me and I can encourage them. God will take care of the rest. You may not know where to work. You might be saying, man, I've got offers from several companies, you know, and I don't know which one to choose. What's the will of God? Well, you know it's the will of God for you to provide for your family. You know it's the will of God for you to be in an environment where you can be a witness. So God, I pray that you would get me the right job. Close the doors that you don't want me to go through. God, you're the God who closes doors no man can open, and you open doors no man can close. So God, I believe you for your will for my life, God, and I will listen for your voice and follow you. And when you connect with the Father, when you connect with the heart of God, you may end up finding yourself in a place where you thought, man, this didn't look like the best option, and yet you know it's God's will because now you've connected with him and you've heard his voice. Only God can handle your situation. You know that? You can't even handle your situation. You know how I know that? Because you wouldn't be praying about your situation if you could handle it. Amen? See, I know I can't handle my life because I am driven to the Father every day. Pressures and needs and stress, all those things. And yet, I know that God can handle my situation. The Bible tells us he won't give us more than we can handle. And therefore, when we pray and we connect with the Father, we know that we can leave it trusting God. Some of you guys tonight at this altar, you poured out your hearts before the Lord. Listen, God can handle your situation. He can handle it. Look at what it says in the book of Psalms, chapter 5, verse number 2, in the New Living Translation. He says, listen to my cry for help, my King and my God, for I pray to no one but you. We're not praying to an idol, not praying to the roof, not praying to the rocks or the sun or any other thing, not praying to a person, a man, or a woman who's on the earth or who has lived before us. We're praying to the Father himself. We have an entrance before God. And as we do, God will make life work. Leonard Ravenhill said this, to be much for God, we must be much with God. If you're going to do something in life, if you're going to be much for God, then you're going to have to connect with the Father so that you can be much with God. As you do, the power that you need, the resource that you need, the provision that you need will be readily available for you. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you tonight that, Lord, we can connect with you openly, God, that you give us entrance to be with you in your presence. God, tonight we ask your presence in this place. We ask, God, Lord, you're already here. You came in when we came in with you, God, because we carry you in our hearts. You said when two or three are gathered in your name, there you are in the midst of them. So God, I thank you that you're in the midst of your church tonight, speaking to our hearts, leading us to pray as we ought to. And tonight, we don't want to just have empty words, vain repetitions, God. We don't want our hearts to be apart from you. Lord, we want to connect with you. Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed and holy be your name, God. Lord, tonight we declare your will, that your kingdom come. And that your will be done here on the earth just as it is in heaven. God, forgive us. Cleanse us, Lord. We're a people with unclean hands. In a nation, God, that has turned their backs on you. And we pray, Lord, that you forgive us. We repent of our way. We repent of being prayerless. God, we repent of being calloused and hard-hearted towards the things of God, not believing. Lord, we repent and we turn to you. God, forgive us. Lord, where we have been slack and lazy, God. And Lord, tonight we strengthen the feeble knees. We strengthen the hands, God. And we fold them in prayer, Lord. And we pray, God, that you forgive us. God, we also choose to walk in forgiveness as you commanded us. We forgive those who have sinned against us, Lord. We release them in the name of Jesus. We commit them to your care. We forgive as God in Christ forgave us. God, we ask that you give us this day our daily bread. Lord, we want to receive our strength, our nourishment, everything that we have, everything that we are, everything that we ever will be, God, from you and from your word. We ask that you lead us. Lead us and guide us, Holy Spirit. Lead us into all truth. Lead us in your way everlasting, God. Lead us by your Spirit. Guide us. Lead us not into temptation. Lord, I know we'll be tempted to stay back. I know we'll be tempted to not pray, to not press in, to not connect. I know we'll be tempted into sin, which will get us down, God. But Lord, lead us not into temptation. Lead us away from that, God. And deliver us from evil. Lord, shield this church, shield this family from the evil one. Protect us, God. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. God, we declare your praise in this place tonight. God, we love you. In Jesus' name. Come on, let's give the Lord a praise tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. I just want to take some time and pray tonight. Is that okay? So, you know, I don't know what we're doing, but we're going to pray as we feel led. You know what, Dr. Powell, will you grab that microphone over there? Will you just come up here? You know, this Wednesday we're having a missions conference, and I just want to pray. And would you pray in English y Español? Okay. Por favor. Go ahead, sir.
Let's pray. Father God, we're just grateful that you give us the opportunity to host this missions conference, Father. There's so much happening in the world. Your idea was to the world, Lord God. You never came for one section of people, but you came for all people, Father. And we ask that you would absolutely translate that through our conference, through our church this week, Lord God. We're here to host them. We're here to serve them as they move the gospel around the world in every area, Lord God. We're so grateful that you've given us this opportunity, that you've put that heart and mindset in our senior leaders, Father, to be a world outreach center, to be a center to reach out to all the parts of the world, Lord God, in every language. Your gospel will not be stopped in every area, Father God. And so we pray for them today, and we ask that you would absolutely ignite something in us to reach out to the world, to our closest neighbors, and from there on, all over, Father God. And so we just right now, first of all, I just want to be grateful that you give us that opportunity. We pray for them. Those are missionaries that are coming. I just believe you're going to encourage them to continue to advance the gospel in every area that they're at this very day, Father. I'll pray in Spanish. Señor, te damos gracias que eres un Dios fiel. Yo te pido que tú hagas una obra en esta semana de las misiones, Señor. Tú tienes un corazón para el mundo, un deseo global, un deseo para avanzar tu evangelio en absolutamente todas las partes del mundo. Yo te pido hoy que tú lo hagas a través de nuestra iglesia. Señor, te doy gracias que somos una iglesia con un enfoque mundial, con un enfoque multilingual, y tú vas a hacer tu obra en todas las partes del mundo. En el nombre de Jesús te lo pedimos hoy. Amén.
Amén. Amén. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's do this. I hear Reverend Elijah playing our song. And I want you to go ahead and sing that song. As they sing that song, I want you guys to pray. I don't want you to sing. I want you to pray, okay? But they're just going to continue to sing the praises of God and keep us in an atmosphere. And I want you guys to get up if you have the ability. And I want you to walk around the room. Some of you guys need to get up in the upper tiers over there. You guys in the family room, you guys can do this too with your children. All right? And I want you guys to just lay hands on the seats, because missionaries are coming here. And they're, some of them are coming discouraged. Some of them are coming in need of provision. Some of them are coming with a desire to hear from God and to receive something that they can take back to the nation that they're ministering in. And so I want you to pray as you feel led. And if you need to stop at a seat and just pray, maybe you've got your prayer language and you want to just minister in the Spirit over that chair. You don't even know what's going on, but you can allow the Spirit of God to intercede through you. Let's connect with the Father on behalf of our delegates and the people that are going to be coming. And maybe you get a burden for a nation. Just start to pray for that nation. Start to lift up the people. Start to pray that the gospel infiltrates, that the light of the glory of God shines in that dark place, and you just lift up that nation. So come on, let's all stand if you have the ability and walk around, lay hands on the seat, and let's pray. Come on, let's pray.
Holy is the land, and we are.
wife gets ready, she's going to read a scripture and pray. But in a moment after she prays, I want you guys to grab somebody, all right? Find a prayer partner and just lift them up. Just pray for them. And just connect with the Father on their behalf. Pastor Jess.
We've been doing a prayer series in Women Rock on Thursday mornings for the past, I think it's like 5 weeks or something like that. If you want to, just because you're a man does not mean you can't listen to the messages, because God has been touching our hearts. And as we began to give into what it is God needs us to give into, which is prayer and time with Him, He's been speaking deeply to us. And I believe that God gave us a word in the very beginning when you were talking about getting close with God and just wanting to talk to you. God just wants to be with us. He wants that intimate relationship with us. What we long for with maybe a husband or a wife or a boyfriend or a girlfriend, you see, that will never, ever satisfy our souls the way that God wants to satisfy those longings and those desires. And the Lord gave us these scriptures in Jeremiah 29:11. It says, "For I know the thoughts that I think for you, says the Lord, of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and to give you a hope." I love that, because He lays out that He already has good things laid out. He already has the plan, right? And then He goes into verse 12 and it says, "Then you will call upon Me and go and pray to Me, and then I will listen to you." You see, that is just something very simple. He says, "I've got the plan, so come to Me. Come talk to Me. I will listen to you because I love you. There's nothing too big. There's nothing too small. There's nothing too intimate. There's nothing too private, because I know it all anyways. I already know what I laid out for you." And God just wants us to connect with Him. In verse 12, and it says, "Then you will call upon Me, you will pray, and I will listen." Verse 13, "And you will seek Me, and you will find Me. And when you search for Me with all of your heart," verse 14, "I will be found by you, says the Lord. I will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations, from all the places where I've driven you, says the Lord. I will bring you to a place for which I cause you to be carried away captive." You see, He's saying He will rescue us. He will deliver us. Those things that maybe have had you in bondage, those things, those thoughts that you can't get rid of, those anxieties that hold you bound, and those things that go through your mind constantly, and those things that become a weakness for you, and you find them as a separation between you and God. He says, "Oh, son and daughter of the Most High, I made you. I know you. I want to know you deeply. But I want you to know Me this much. As much as I love you and I know the hairs on your head and what I've done inside of you, I need you to get close. Oh, get close, son and daughter. Because I want to pour out those things in you. I want that intimate relationship. I want you to get so close that you know when I'm pulling on your heart and saying, don't go there. Remember what that does for you? Remember where that takes you? Because I got a different plan for you. Oh, I got another path for you." You see, He loves us so much. He loves us so much. Let's pray. Oh, Holy Spirit, we just love You. Oh, we just love You. We just love You. We love You. I love You. And Holy Spirit, I ask as a congregation that we just submit our hearts to You right now. And Lord, I ask that as we surrender our hearts, that in faith, God, that You would just give us a word. Lord, Your word says that if we seek You, that we will find You. Lord, Your word says that You have a plan. God, You know what's ahead. You know what's to come. You know where to go. You know what to say. You know where we need to be. So God, we lift up these lives. Everybody lift up your hands. Lord, we lift up our lives. Oh God, we lift up our hearts. We lift up our desires and our wants and the things that happen in our world, Lord. Those things we have no control over, and those things that, God, we've tried to control. God, we release them to You today. God, we give them back to You. Your word says to cast our care on You, for You care. Lord, we release them. And here's our lives, God. We just want to be close to You. We just want to seek You. We just want to love You. We just want to know You. Oh God, our hearts just want to long for You. God, we want to love what You love. God, we want to hate what You hate. Oh Holy Spirit, we want to do what You need us to do. Our lives are not our own, but they're here for You. We want to be Your hands and we want to be Your feet. We want to be equipped to do the will and the way of God. We want to use the gifts and the talents You've placed inside of us for Your kingdom come, Your will be done. Oh God, meet us here at the Rock. Be with us. Dwell with us. Let Your presence be. Oh, Holy Spirit, rest with us. As we pray together, God, I pray that there would be just such a power between us, God. Your word says that when two or more are gathered, that you are in the midst of us. Go ahead and turn to a couple people and find some people. Whether it's two people, whether it's three people. Maybe try and get out of your comfort zone. Say, hi, my name is. Because you're all brothers and sisters. You just don't know each other yet. We're all family. And get together. Ask what they need prayer for. And listen, you long prayers, you. We're not going to go crazy long. We're just going to ask heaven for it, and we're going to put it in heaven. And whatever's loosed on earth is loosed in heaven. Whatever's bound on earth is bound in heaven. So we have power in our prayer. So pray together.
Wrap up your prayers. If you haven't finished praying yet, go ahead and wrap them up. And if you didn't get to somebody, just commit that you're going to pray for them tonight afterwards. You're going to connect with the Father on their behalf. Praise the Lord. I'm going to ask a couple of people to come up and pray some quick prayers. I want to ask, I thought I saw Beth. Is Beth in here, Sandell? I thought, come on up here, Beth, real quick. And then Reverend Joe, come on up, my brother. And then Dr. Kanga, would you come up? All right, a couple of you guys, I want you guys to come up real quick, and I'm going to have you guys pass the mic, and I'm going to have you guys pray in a couple different areas. So Beth, I'm going to have you pray. Beth has been kind of revamping the first-time visitor area, and so, you know, maybe you've seen the signs out there on the side over there, the new welcome signs, and then you noticed we're starting to move some furniture and stuff around, and there's people standing out there waiting in bags and all that kind of stuff. So we've been welcoming people, and she's been trying to incorporate people more and more, and so we're trying to get people connected. You know, we don't want to have just people come and you know, oh, it's cool, we had a great time in church, and then but nobody really noticed, you know, and so we want to really connect people. So I want you to pray just for people to continue to come and for the church to grow, all right? And especially as we're hitting Easter, you know, we're coming up on Easter. Then Dr. Kanga, if you would just pray for our Easter services, just cover them however you feel led and just pray, you know, the Spirit of God, the sunrise service, all that kind of stuff that we're doing, and just lift up the team here at The Rock and the pastors and the people and everybody, you know, that we would have a great Easter season. And then Reverend Joe, I want you to wrap it up. And you know, the week after Easter oftentimes is like the downer. You know what I mean? We have this great, wonderful, massive Easter weekend. And then the next week, it's a ghost town. You know, it's like, cricket, cricket, where'd they all go? So I want you to pray that we have a lasting impact and that people come back to church, that it's not just an Easter experience, but that people really connect with the Father in a way that they can't get away from it, that they come back, all right? So I want you guys to go ahead and just pass the mic, okay? As you guys get done praying, just keep going down, all right?
Heavenly Father, we just come before you, God, and right now, God, we just want to thank you for the visitors who have been coming, Father, for the souls who have been coming into this church, God, but there are still more souls to be saved, God. There are still more lives to be changed, Father, and right now, God, we intercede on that, on their behalf, God. Oh, Jesus, that you would bring people into your church, God. Oh, God, that there would be a desire for the real thing, God. Oh, God, I pray in the name of Jesus that people would be so dissatisfied with the things that think will they will fulfill them, God, that they'll be so dissatisfied, God, with the drugs and the drinking and the TV and the magazines, God, and everything, God, that they think is going to fix them, God. Let them desire something real, Jesus, and that is you, Father. So we thank you that you bring them in, God. Oh, that there'd be new people coming through these doors, God. Oh, that, God, this congregation would take it upon themselves to make every person feel welcomed and feel special and, God, feel loved in this place. God, we thank you that you bring them in, because this church is not just a yacht club, but this is a hospital for the hurting, and our doors are open, Jesus. So we thank you that you bring them in, God. And those, God, who have been hurt by the church in the past, those, God, who have walls up against pastors in the church because of things that have happened, oh, in Jesus' name, God, break down those walls, Father. Oh, God, send a saint to invite them to church. We thank you that there would be something on the inside of them that is changing, Father. Oh, God, when they come into this place, that the Holy Spirit would break those walls, Jesus. Oh, we thank you for these visitors, God, that they would not be visitors for long, but they would soon become members, God. And if they can come and sit in these seats, God, they can sit under the Word of God. And if they sit under the Word of God, they can change. And if they change, then they can reach others, Jesus, because it's all about you, Jesus. So we thank you, and we speak that these seats will be filled in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Lord.
Father God, we thank you. We thank you for the opportunity to celebrate Easter. Easter is the time for the revelation of your love. The word says clearly that for God so loved the world that he gave. And that gift that you gave to the world is revealed to us on Easter when your son came and died to reveal your love. As people pour out into the churches around the world, especially at The Rock, we pray that they come to experience your love, that the love of God will touch their hearts, that they will never live the same, but they will live touched by the name of Jesus. For there is power in that name. So I pray that on Easter, as people pour into the church, Jesus will be revealed. I pray that the love of God will be revealed. I pray that people will not live the same. They will be healed. They will be touched. They will be loved. They will surrender their life to the love of Christ. Father, Father, as they come, may they humble themselves. May the broken be healed. May the sick be touched. May all the people who have love, may they gain Christ. And as they leave, may they not live the same, but dedicate and give their life to you, that they may return and have a perpetual inheritance in Christ. Amen.
Amen, amen. And Father, we just celebrate tonight, dear God. We thank you in advance, dear God, that Father, not only are our lives going to be touched, not only are we going to have tons and tons of salvation, but Father, those that taste and see that you are good, that they're going to return the week after, years after, dear God, that Father, generations will be penetrated by the word, dear God, that men and women that were far from you, dear God, will be brought back, dear God, by the blood of the Lamb. Father Lord, we thank you, dear God, that San Bernardino will be impacted forever, dear God, by this Easter service. We thank you that they're going to return, dear God, and they're going to have a hunger for the word, that, dear God, they're going to be on fire for you, dear God. Father Lord, that they're going to go and they're going to talk to their families and their other relatives, dear God, and tell them how good the Lord is, Father. We thank you for the word that's going to be preached, and we believe it's going to fall on good ground, that it's going to produce good fruit, dear God. Dear God, that we're going to have a church revival, dear God, because men and women and children, dear God, are going to come, dear God, and they're going to grow under the teaching of the word of God here at this church. We thank you for the youth. We thank you for children. We thank you for this church, dear God, that Father is going to grow after this Easter service, dear God, because they're going to come hungry for you. They're going to want more and more and more and more of you, dear God. And we're going to see with our eyes your glory, your goodness, your power in our midst, dear God. We thank you tonight. In Jesus' mighty name, amen, 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 amen.
Hallelujah. I want you guys just to have a seat for a moment. And I want to make one last God connection before we leave this place. I want everybody to just give me a couple minutes of your attention. Don't let anything distract you. Turn your cell phones off. Listen, don't let anybody else getting up disturb you right now. I want you to lock in. Because the Bible tells us that if we had cherished sin in our heart, that God would not have heard our prayers. It's very important that you don't come into a service like tonight and have an experience with God and encounter God. And I could show you tears on the altar up here where people came and had a God connection. But it's not enough just to attend a church service. It's not enough to cry in the presence of God. It's not enough to pray a prayer and expect that you've made the most important God connection like we heard talked about a moment ago in our prayers. And I want to make sure that your heart is right with God. Jesus said the God connection will make you born again. That you will now change course, change destinies. Whereas you were dead, now you will be born again spiritually and made alive. Now your destiny or your destination is heaven. And now you're connected. You've been made alive. Now you're one with the Father. And if you haven't yet been born again, tonight I want to give you that opportunity. But it doesn't just happen because you came to church. You got to know that. It doesn't just happen because you pray a prayer. You got to know that. It doesn't happen because you've been good or smart or nice or pretty or handsome or whatever. Sometimes people think they can be good enough that that makes them right with the Father and that they're connected or because they're living a good life or prospering. It doesn't matter how much good you do, how much money you give to charities, how nice you are to your neighbors, you will never be good enough to make it with God. It doesn't connect you with the Father. Sometimes people think if they were raised in church or their parents told them they were Christians growing up because they weren't some other religion like Buddhist or Muslim or Hindus, that by default they were lumped into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven, being born again. And yet, do you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you were raised in church or because your parents told you you're a Christian, or because you went to religious classes or were baptized or christened as a child, or wore religious jewelry or a t-shirt that said Jesus, or because you're not some other religion that by default God lumps you into the category of being a Christian. It doesn't work like that. You're not connected with God, being born again, headed for heaven, because you were raised in church. Sometimes people think that just because, you know, they volunteered in church. They helped out, sang in a choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions, taught in the Bible classes. Or because people thought of them as a leader, that they get to go to heaven and that they're connected with God. But you know, once again, we're back to good works, aren't we? It's just a bunch of religious activity. And yet, it will not connect you with God, making you born again. Sometimes people think that if they just know about God or they have a Bible, can read some scriptures or even quote some scriptures, that that means that they're born again, they're connected with the Father. But did you know that demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? They're not Christians. Do you know the devil himself can quote scripture? He's not connected with God, born again, headed for heaven. So everybody look up here at me for a second. This is not about what you have in your head. Not about having head knowledge about who Jesus is that gets you right with God. Now you're connected with the Father, headed for heaven. But rather, this is about your heart. This is a heart connection. Being born again isn't religious activity. It isn't vain, repetitious prayers. It isn't church attendance. It isn't scripture memorization. Being born again means that you've given God all of your heart and all of your life. It's a God connection where you surrender all that you are, all that you ever will be, to the Father. And you invite the Father to come into your heart and to do what you couldn't do. See, you couldn't save yourself. You couldn't connect with God. You couldn't ascend to heaven. So God had to come down in the form of his Son. And he had to die in our place, taking on the punishment for our sin. And he had to go be buried in a grave and stay there for 3 days. And on the third day, he rose again from the grave. And he ascended to the Father and he said, "Now whoever believes in me and loves me, whoever gives me all of their heart and all of their life, then now they will be reconnected with the Father because Jesus opened the way." Tonight, you know in your heart of hearts whether or not you've been born again, whether or not you're connected with the Father. Some of you maybe in this place were serving God at one time, or maybe you thought that you were a Christian and you backslid, you walked away from God. Tonight is your night to come back. Some of you guys have never connected with the Father. Maybe this is your first time in a church in your life. Tonight, it's a divine appointment. God knew you would be here tonight. And he wants to connect with you. He wants you to be born again. So you can head to heaven for eternity. Here's how this is going to work. I want to offer you this opportunity. And I want you that have had that revelation, you know where you're at with God right now in your heart of hearts. You're saying, "I want to connect with the Father. I want to be born again. I want to head for heaven. Denying my presence in hell." In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, bang, pop my hands together. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, "I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, connected with God, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell." I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. You might be thinking, "Well, wait a second. Time out, Pastor. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed." Yeah, you might be embarrassed. Let's push past that. Because what's more important? Saving face and not being embarrassed? Or being connected with the Father? See, no one would make the trade of saying, "Well, I guess I'll just sit here and head to hell." No one's going to do that. And yet, your insecurities, your flesh is going to try and talk you out of this right now. The devil's whispering in your ears, "Don't do this, you don't have to." No, if you want to go to heaven, you must be born again. You can do that in this safe and friendly place tonight. Probably won't even be embarrassed. Jesus made this statement. He said, "If you confess me before man, I'll confess you before my Father in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you." Tonight is your night of salvation. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, if you're watching by television in the foyer or down at the Love Rock Cafe, get ready to get your hand up. God sees, God's watching. Then you can tell an usher or come into the church service right afterwards. Online, God is watching you right now, and you can raise your hand wherever you're at. We're going to pray together tonight. Who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Tonight is your night. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand? Maybe you did walk away, you backslid, and now you found yourself in a place of being lukewarm. Jesus said, "I wish that you were hot or cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth." So tonight, if you're a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance, hoping that that's going to get you right with God, listen, it's time to just say yes to Jesus and surrender all. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, 3. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now if that's you. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Thank you. Who else today? There's 6 wise people already on this side. There's 7. Got you over there. There's 8 up on top over there. Got you. 8 wise people already. Anybody else real quick? There's 9. Got you right there. 10, 11. Got you guys. Thank you. Thank you. Who else? Anybody else real quick? 10 or 11 wise people. Anybody else? Anybody else? They're pointing over here. I'm looking for you. Got you right there. Thank you. Number 12. God bless you. There's a dozen wise people. 13 in the family. I've got you over there. Got you over there. I think I got that hand already right there. Thank you. God bless you. Who else? Who else today? There's about 13 wise people. Anybody else? Real quick. Want to make sure that you have this opportunity. Anybody else? Number 14, number 15. You sitting there wondering if you should? Yeah, you should. Let's go for God tonight. If that's you. Is there anybody else? Anybody else? I'm going to pray with you guys, and I don't want you to miss out on this opportunity. Anybody else? Last call real quick, and then I'm going to wrap this up. I'm going to wrap this up. Anybody else? All right. All 13 of you, you raised your hand, or if you should have raised your hand, but you didn't, get your stuff. Get a friend if you need a friend. I want you guys to get in the aisle and meet me up front. We're going to pray together to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again. Let's all stand and welcome them. And if you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, come on down right now. Come on down to the front. Let's pray together. Come on. Come on, come on. They're coming. Come on, you can come too. Anybody else? Come on. Come on, you can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. For the family rooms, or if your child raised their hand in here, hey, they're welcome. Bring them on down right now. They will remember this. This is good for them. All right, they're still coming. Come on, we'll wait for you. If you need to come, come on down. All right. Hey, everybody up front, go ahead and look up here for a second. You can put a smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing. You came to give God all of your heart. You came to give God all of your life. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. It's a simple prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. Listen, this is not about the words coming out of your mouth. This is about your heart connecting with the Father, all right? You're going to be born again, brand new. I don't know what God does to make that happen, but something's going to take place in the Spirit right now. You're going to be connected with the Father, made alive on the inside. And then God's going to work that connection into every area of your life like we talked about tonight. So now, let's bow our heads. Let's close our eyes. And everybody join in with this. And if you're watching on the live stream or by television, wherever you're at, get ready to pray this prayer out loud and from your heart if you have the ability. Here we go. Let's say this together. Say, Father God, I come to you now in Jesus' name. And I ask that you would come into my heart. Be my Lord and my Savior. Wash me with your blood. Forgive me of my sin. Cleanse me completely. And make me brand new from the inside. And I thank you, God, that Jesus died for me. And now, Lord, I ask that you fill me with your Holy Spirit. Let it be known that from this day on, I am a Christian. I'm headed for heaven. I'm born again, denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise tonight. Hallelujah. All right. So excited for your new life. Now listen, welcome to the family of God. So excited. You're brothers and sisters now, all right? Okay? Right over here to my right, your left, this is one of the servants here at The Rock. This is Pastor Joel. He wants to give you some free information, a couple little booklets that our pastors wrote that will help you to find out what to do next in your walk with God. Then he wants to connect you not only with the Father, but with a friend here, okay? Someone who will come alongside you and help you to learn more about the Father so that you connect with him more and connect with his love, connect with his voice, connect with others, all right? And they'll talk to you about how that works, and they'll let you come right back out. Easy, free, okay? Listen to what he has to say. You guys need to do it because it'll help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord. You don't go back to where you're coming from, but now you go on with God, okay? So if you guys can make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel. Let's give him a hand. Hallelujah.